Hello everyone, how you all?
Welcome to our next class. In today's class, we shall deal with the topic of pollination control. In last class, we have dealt with the reproduction in plants, and in continuation to this, we deal with this topic because that is the mode of reproduction we have learned there. Now, how the some mechanisms that promote such mode, and what happens, some important process that happens there, some important conditions. What will be there to promote such modes, we shall see in this, and the mechanism of pollination control is very helpful in the plant breeding. So please keep a keen observation and learn today's class, and let's enter to this. Before entering, please follow me on my Instagram, Time to be Intellectual, Facebook, Time to be Intellectual, and YouTube, Manoj Patike channel, and let's continue to the topic. Pollination control. In the pollination control, there up to the reproduction means fertilization process we learned, and now we shall see the flowering process and some modes of pollination and such mechanisms what happens. Anthesis. Don't confuse anthesis with anther. Anthesis is the process of opening of, in the process of flowering, the first opening of flower is known as anthesis. Means it may be anther or pistil, the first opening flower, the female flower or male flower, among them the first opening flower is considered as anthesis. The process of anthesis has begun, and the process of opening of such flowers is known as anthesis. So anthesis is very important because it helps us to know when the it is favorable for us to go breeding in particular plant. It depends on various conditions, and it is different for with respect to different plants. So this is very helpful to undergo the breeding process, and such process is known as anthesis. Next, modes of pollination. What are the modes of pollination? Self pollination and cross pollination, often cross pollination we say, and we shall see one by one. First, what is pollination? Pollination is the process of transfer of pollen from anther to stigma is known as pollination. Now let's see self-pollination. We also call self-pollination as autogamy, and the definition of it is the pollen from an anther may fall on the stigma of the same flower or another flower of the same plant. One condition, it may pollinate on the or fall on the stigma of same flower, or in a plant, here one flower will be there, here one flower will be there. The anther from here can fall into here, and in such condition also we consider them as self-pollination itself. In the process of self-pollination, 0 to 5% of cross-pollination may be observed, and till 5% of cross-pollination we consider them as self-pollinated flowers itself. And here, as a rule, what the hermaphrodite flowers are very favorable, and even a monoecious condition is must and should be there, otherwise the self-pollination is highly impossible, we can say. And let's see the mechanism that is favorable for this self-pollination. Okay friends, now let's see the mechanisms that promote the self-pollination. Before we see these mechanisms, first we should know that here we are favoring the self-pollination, means transfer of pollen to the flower of same plant or to the same flower. So remember that and see these mechanisms. First we shall see the cleistogamy. Cleistogamy is a condition in which flowers never open at all. Please look into the image I have shown here. In this, observe the second and third image. See, in these second and third image, these are the examples of viola plant that are present underground. In the underground part, they flowers is in this shape. See, they never open at all. Within that itself, the pollination takes place. The self-pollination, when it never opens, there is no possibility of the occurrence of the cross-pollination. So self-pollination, in the third image, you can see how they are developed, ovules are developed in that. And that is the cleistogamy. We can observe these in wheat, oat, barley, and some other plants also. But complete cleistogamy, complete chasmogamy will not be present in any conditions. Now it's an example you are seeing here. that is Pleistogamy, and observe the first image here. That is the example for the Chasmogamia flower. In this viola plant, this is the above ground flower that is opened only after the pollination. Such conditions we call them as Chasmogamy, and the above ground flower in the viola plant is a Chasmogamous flower. It opens only after the pollination. Then there is no possibility of occurrence of cross pollination because there is no transfer of pollen grains from other plant to this, right? So these are the two important mechanisms. There comes the another mechanism that favors the self-pollination, that is the homogamy. Homogamy means maturation of anther and stigma at the same time. See, it should transfer from anther to stigma, right? If the anther should desist in the proper time, at the same time the stigma should be receptive. If both the conditions are favorable itself, then the maximum transfer of pollen grains will take place. So the maturation of anther and stigma at the same time should take place, then the flower favors the self-pollination. In such condition we call them as homogamy. There comes the another condition, that is bisexuality. In the beginning I have told, in the most of the plant, hermaphrodite condition is most common and mostly it should be present, because the hermaphrodite condition, even though in some hermaphrodite condition we see cross pollination and all, but that's not the condition. But to occur this self pollination, hermaphrodite condition is most favorable, because when both are together, when both are in the same plant, then the maximum possibility of pollination will take place, right? So that is the condition, hermaphrodite condition will take place. It should be present, it should must be present for this mechanism of self to promote the self pollination. Let's come to next mechanism, that is the position of anthers. See, I have shown you the image here. In this image, I have shown you the two conditions. In the first condition, the stigma is very lengthy, the length of the stigma is very high, and the length of the anther is very low. Then in such condition, the cross pollination will be favorable. So such conditions are not favorable for the self pollination. So see in the second image, where the position of, the length of the pistil or the stigma is low and the length of the anther is high. Means this is the one example, and see the anther should be present around the stigma in such a way to promote the self pollination. The anther that is present around the stigma, this should be such a way that these stamens or the anthers, the pollen that contains in the anthers, should only fall on the stigma of the same flower. The other pollen from other plant should not fall. So the position or the length, the angle where it should be present will matter a lot. Even in the condition where they are equal also, then there is the maximum possibility of self-pollination itself. So the position of anthers, the position how it is present will also matters. Next come to the leguminous plants in the papilionaceous flower. See, I have shown you the papilionaceous flower here. In this flower, what happens is the stamens and stigma are enclosed within the petals. These some petals are there, they enclose them, they don't allow the opening of such these stamen and stigma. In such condition, there will be no transfer of pollen from other plant. Then it promotes the self-pollination, for example in the black gram, green gram and all. These are the many important mechanisms that is favorable, that promote the self-pollination. Now let's see the genetic consequence, what happens due to this self-pollination. See, this self-pollination will help to increase the homozygosity in the population. The homozygosity increases. In the most self-pollinated species, they are homozygous itself. And due to this self-pollination, the homozygosity will increase. And these self-pollinated species never show the inbreeding depression. And there are some considerable amount of heterosis is observed in these species. Okay friends, now let's see cross-pollination, or we also call them as allogamy condition. When pollen from a plant or flower is transferred to the stigma of flower of another plant, not of same plant, to flower of another plant, then such process is called as cross pollination. When a pollen from flowers of one plant are transmitted to the stigma of flowers of another plant, this is the definition. And there are many carriers that are transferring pollen to stigma of another plant. That is through anemophily, means through winds it can transfer, or hydrophily, through water it can transfer, or entomophily, there are many pollinating insects are present. They may also be responsible for that. In such condition, we call them as entomophily. And these cross-pollinated species, 5 to 10% of self-pollination may occur. In there, we have seen 0 to 5% of cross-pollination may be occur in the self-pollinated species. Here, 5 to 10% of self-pollination may occur. And the mechanisms that favorable for the cross-pollination are, first, we shall see the bicliny or unisexuality, which is there. Here, either staminate or pistillate flowers are there. The flowers are either staminate, means only stamens are there, or only pistils are there. We have seen the definition in the last videos. I will give them in the description box. Staminate or pistillate flowers will be present. Okay friends, under the diclinic condition, there are two another mechanism, that is monoicy and diicy. Let's see those. Monoicy condition, where staminate and pistillate flowers are present in the same plant. When we say a same plant, there comes the matter of inflorescence. It is either in the same inflorescence or different inflorescence. Yes, there are two conditions in which either in the same inflorescence. Please look into the image I am showing here. This is the example of castor. In this castor inflorescence, see the above part, from the tip, there are female, that is the red flowers, or the, we can say, dark some flowers, violet flowers you can observe, and in the lower part you are observing the white or yellow flowers. The white or yellow flowers are the male flowers, or they are staminate, and the above are pistillate. They are in the same inflorescence. This is a one monoicy condition. Now let's see another image. Yes, this is the image. This is the image of maize plant, in which you observe the staminate and pistillate flowers in the different inflorescence. Yes, in the above part, or the in the top, you observe the tassel. In the tassel, that is the staminate part and it's the male part. That is one inflorescence. And you observe the silk below, and that is the female part, and that is another inflorescence. The staminate and pistillate are present on different inflorescence. These two conditions exist in the monoicy under the diclinic condition. There comes the diicy condition, in which the staminate and pistillate flowers are present on different plants. That is papaya, asparagus, you can say. Please look into the image I am showing now. In this image, you observe three conditions. One is hermaphrodite, staminate and pistillate. The big one is the hermaphrodite, then staminate, then pistillate. Actually, hermaphrodite condition is now we have induced them, but naturally most of the case they are either staminate or pistillate papaya plants. In the staminate plants, the flowers, only stamens containing flowers, that is staminate flowers will be there, or in another plant only pistil containing flowers, pistillate flowers will be there. So diicy is an example where staminate and pistillate present on two different plants. Now we have completed the diclinic condition. Now let's see the dichogamic condition. Dichogamic condition. In this condition, the stamens and pistils mature at different times. You know, position here, the time that matters. The time of maturation in the self-pollinated species, I told you that if they mature at the same time, then it is most favorable condition for the self-pollination. But in a contrast to such condition, in under the cross-pollination, the protogyny and protoandry condition exists, where the maturation time should be different. They should not mature at the same time. When we say it should not mature at the same time, there comes two possibilities. That is, first the staminate flowers, the stamens should mature, or the pistil should mature. And be careful, I am speaking in a hermaphrodite condition. In such condition, if the stamen mature before the pistil, then we say this as protoandry condition. Protoandry condition, the best example is maize. See, the tassels it present, it contains mature before the silk. So such condition is the protoandry, best example is maize. Now comes the protogyny condition, in which the female part or the pistil part should mature before the stamens. That is protogyny condition, and the best example for the protogyny condition is the Bajra plant. Okay friends, now let's see heterostyly. See, look into this image. This image I have already shown you in the self-pollinated mechanisms. In this, they vary the heights so that that favors the cross-pollination. Here means the pistil part should be height and the stamen part should be low, such that it favors the maximum of cross-pollination, and such condition favors the or promotes the cross-pollination. Such mechanism is known as heterostyly, and it is a form of hercogamy. I will explain you what is hercogamy is. Hercogamy, the definition of it is the spatial difference between the stamen and pistil. Means there is no link between, there is a difference, there is a barrier for between them, or we can say there is a much spatial difference between them, so that they don't favor the self-pollination. Yes, such a mechanism is observed in the alfalfa plant. Here what happens is, see, this is this is the flower, stamen, pistil, stamen. See, this stigma part is covered with the waxy film. This waxy film will not break naturally. It should be broken by some other agents, such as honeybees. Honeybees are the visitors. Whenever they visit, this waxy film will break and then favors the pollination. And most of the time, it leads to a cross-pollination. Such a mechanism, we call them hercogamy. See here, there is no attachment or the togetherness of these two stamens and pistils. There is a special difference between them. The barrier here is waxy film. Such mechanism is a hercogamy, and heterostyly is a form of hercogamy. Okay, let's complete it. And self-incompatibility. This is a very important tool, and self-incompatibility and male sterility both has a very detailed explanation, detailed note for that. In further classes, I will deal with them. Let's see the definition. Pollen from a flower fail to fertilize the flower of same plant. If the pollen is taken in a plant, if it is failed to fertilize the same flower, the flower of the same plant, then we call them as self-incompatibility. That is incompatibility or inability of the pollen to fertilize the flower of the same plant. And the best example for this is Nicotiana species and all. And in further classes, I will explain you in detail about this self-incompatibility. Next comes the male sterility. In this, the absence of functional pollen grains, or otherwise the functional hermaphrodite flowers, in such condition we call them as male sterile condition, in which the pollen is not functional, it is not functional in nature, or even the hermaphrodite flower it possesses will not be in function, it needs pollen source from other plants, then such condition we call them as male sterile condition. We have a detailed class in further classes. And some process they possess is GMS, CMS and CGMS, that is genetic male sterility, cytoplasmic male sterility and cytoplasmic genetic male sterility conditions, and the genetic consequences of the cross-pollination. We have completed the mechanisms through male sterility. Now we shall see what are the genetic consequences that may occur. Yes, the self-pollination will lead to homozygous condition in a population. Here it promotes the heterozygosity in a population, heterozygous nature in a population. It leads to variations. Such a conditions is favorable in the, it promoted by the cross-pollinated species. And the occurrence of inbreeding depression is more here. If we go on self-pollinate these cross-pollinated species, they lead to the inbreeding depression. And consideration of heterosis is also present in these species. Now let's see another type of the pollination, that is often cross-pollination. It is usually the self-pollinated species in which the cross-pollination will exceed the 5% and may extend up to 30% of cross-pollination. And in such conditions, such species, we call them as often cross-pollination. The best example is jowar, you can say. And they are also very helpful in some part, because they can extend to both sides And thus we end this class. And in this class we have seen the introduction to the pollination control and the self-pollination, cross-pollination, the mechanisms that help them, genetic consequences of a cross-pollination species and all. In further classes, we shall continue these topics. And thanks for watching this video. Please like, share, comment and subscribe to our channel. Because if you have more subscription and more views and give more feedback to me, then it will be more encourageable to me to make more, some more videos. If there is no good response, it will be a bit difficult for me to get motivated. Thank you.